Let's start the today's class. In previous class, we have discussed the enantiomers, diastereomers, and racemic mixtures, right? Last we were discussing racemic mixture. In racemic mixture, dextro and levo compound can be separated. I'll start today's discussion from there itself, and today optical isomerism will be finished. So let's start. Resolution of dextro and levo compound. Dextro and levo compound. See, the basic theme to separate dextro and levo compound from racemic mixture is convert that enantiomeric mixture in diastereomeric mixture. If you have converted, if we are successful to convert that enantiomeric mixture to diastereomeric mixture, we know that the physical property of diastereomers are different, their boiling points are different. We can separate the diastereomer from the mixture by using normal distillation method or fractional distillation method. And after separating them, we can again regain our original compound. For that, we need a reaction that you should know. I'm writing a reaction. You just remember the reaction for today. And next, in further classes, I'll explain the mechanism and process how that reaction is taking place, right? For now, just you remember the reaction. If you are taking carboxylic acid now, take any carboxylic acid and heat this carboxylic acid with alcohol. This one is the carboxylic acid. And another compound that we need is alcohol. Let's say R-SOH is our alcohol, R-COOH is carboxylic acid. React them in acidic medium. Just react them in acidic medium with slight heat. The product is ester. The product formed is ester. While formation of ester, what is happening? The OH group of this carboxylic acid and hydrogen atom of this alcohol will combine together and water molecule will be removed. See, if you are removing the OH group from the carboxylic acid, the one of the valency of carbon will be free, and from alcohol, if you are removing the hydrogen, one valency of oxygen is also going to be free. Just attach this oxygen with the carbon, their free valency will be satisfied, and the product will be R, C double bond O, then oxygen and R dash. Product is what? Ester. So this reaction you should remember for now. I am going to use this reaction and then I'll show you how we can convert enantiomeric mixture to diastereomeric mixture, right? So just copy this reaction and remember for now. Let's say I have an optically active carboxylic acid in our enantiomeric mixture. Suppose I have CH3CH, here it is hydrogen, then deuterium, and one carboxylic group. This carboxylic acid is optically active because it is having one chiral carbon. This is going to be optically active. Now, what is enantiomeric mixture or what is racemic mixture? It is the equimolar mixture of two enantiomers. So, just draw the enantiomer of this carboxylic acid. Take the mirror image. I'm going to take the mirror image. So if we are going to draw the mirror image, deuterium will be on above side and hydrogen will be on down side. COOH is at its place. It is also having one chiral carbon. Both the carboxylic acids are optically active, and these two are enantiomers. These two are enantiomers. Enantiomers. If you are going to take the mixture of these two acids, that will be our racemic mixture. Now, out of these two carboxylic acid, definitely one, if one is dextrorotatory, other is going to be levorotatory. Both are going to rotate the plane polarized light equally in opposite direction. One will rotate the PPL in clockwise direction, other one will rotate the PPL in anti-clockwise direction by equal amount of angle. Now, what I'm going to do, suppose I have a beaker, and in this beaker you are going to place, suppose first one is carboxylic acid A, second one is carboxylic acid B. You are taking the mixture of A and B, right? This is our racemic mixture. Now I'm going to add alcohol in this mixture, and I'll slightly heat with it, with the mixture, and the alcohol that I'm going to take, that is also optically active. And the alcohol, let's say it is CH3CH, let's draw in reverse way, it is CH3CH deuterium, let's say here it is OH, right? This is alcohol, and it is also optically active. I'm going to mix and optically active alcohol in the mixture of A and B, and then I'm going to heat it. What is going to happen? This alcohol will react with both of these acids. If this alcohol is reacting with first acid A, OH of this acid and hydrogen of this alcohol will combine, and water molecule will remove. That is the reaction I was writing previously. So if you remove the water molecule from by the combination of first carboxylic acid and alcohol, the product formed is, let me write the product, it is CH3C hydrogen deuterium carbon oxygen double bond, then one oxygen, then again carbon, hydrogen, deuterium and CH3. This will be the product form when alcohol is going to react with acid A. When this alcohol will react with acid B, again what will happen, the OH group of acid and hydrogen of alcohol will combine, and water molecule will be removed. And after removal of water molecule, ester will be the final product. Let's write the final product. It is CH3C deuterium hydrogen carbon oxygen double bond, oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, deuterium and CH3. These are the two products. Let's say product C and product E, two products are formed. What I'm saying, let us find the configuration of chiral carbon in carboxylic acid that we have drawn. If you find the configuration, this COOH group will have the first priority, hydrogen is fourth priority, deuterium is third priority, and this CH3 is going to be second priority. Lowest priority is on vertical line. Start moving first priority to second priority, and then second priority to third priority. You are moving in anti-clockwise direction, so the configuration of this chiral carbon is going to be S. If the configuration of chiral carbon in first acid, that is A, is S, then configuration of chiral carbon in second acid, that is B, is going to be R, right? And also let us find the configuration of chiral carbon in alcohol. This OH will be of first priority, CH3 will be of second priority, hydrogen fourth priority, deuterium third priority. Start moving first priority to second priority, then second priority to third priority. You are moving in clockwise direction, lowest priority on vertical line, the configuration is going to be R, right? Now, see the situation. We are having two products, product C and product B. if you observe product C and D, both are going to contain 2 chiral carbon. And also observe one more thing, when you are reacting this carboxylic acid and alcohol, this chiral carbon, the chiral carbon atom is not involved in chemical reaction. That OH group of carboxylic acid and hydrogen is involving in chemical reaction, that you are combining and removing the water molecule, right? If the chiral carbon is not involved in the chemical reaction, then during the chemical reaction, the configuration of chiral carbon is not going to change. So what I'm saying, in ester, if you will find the configuration of chiral carbon, it is having 2 chiral carbon. The configuration will be S from the acid and R from the alcohol, right? And in product D, that is the second ester product, if you will see, it is also having 2 chiral carbon, and look at the configuration, it is having R from the carboxylic acid and R from the alcohol. Now you can see, initially we were having 2 compounds, mixture of 2 compounds which were enantiomer, that is what is our racemic mixture. I reacted this mixture with an optically active alcohol, and we are going to get 2 product. And in these 2 product, the configuration of chiral carbon are RS and RR. Definitely these 2 are going to be distereomer, right? If these 2 are would be enantiomers, then the configuration should be inverted, right? But the configuration of both the chiral carbon is not inverted. Configuration of only 1 chiral carbon is inverted. Second chiral carbon is having same configuration. So these 2 compound are going to be distereomers. Now the enantiomeric mixture is converted in distereomeric mixture. The physical and chemical properties of distereomers are different. Now we can separate this distereomeric mixture C and D by using fractional distillation, right? Let us write the statement. Enantiomeric mixture can be converted in distereomeric mixture, and after conversion we can separate them by using distillation method, just because their boiling point are different. If the boiling points of compounds are different, we can separate them by using distillation method, right? Now we can separate C and D. Now the challenge is, we have not obtained our original compound. Original mixture was the mixture of 2 carboxylic acid. So we want to regain our carboxylic acid. For that, what we need to do, one more reaction I am writing. That reaction is the reverse one of the first reaction that we have written. Alcohol plus acid is giving ester in acidic medium. From ester, we can again regenerate our alcohol and ester. How it can be done? Just add water in alcohol, right? Add water in ester. Suppose I have an ester, carbon, oxygen, double bond, oxygen, and let's say RS, this is the ester. If you place this ester in aqueous acidic medium, do not heat it, just provide more and more water. So what is happening, during hydrolysis, this ester will break and our carboxylic acid and alcohol will be regained. So after separating this C and D by using distillation method, we are going to regenerate our alcohol and acid. And for that, we just need to add these two esters in aqueous acidic medium. Just add aqueous acidic medium. Your acid, that is CH3CH, D, COOH, and alcohol, that is CH3CH, D, and OH, will be separated, will be regenerated. Definitely, we know that the physical property of this carboxylic acid and alcohol is going to be different. Again, we will use fractional distillation method or normal distillation method to separate this alcohol and carboxylic acid, and at the end we can get our dextrorotatory carboxylic acid and levorotatory carboxylic acid in different beaker. So the basic theme, basic idea, how to separate the dextro and levo compound from the racemic mixture is just the convert enantiomeric mixture into dextro in diastereomeric mixture, right? And to convert that enantiomeric mixture to diastereomeric mixture, just react with a particular chemical compound, react with a particular compound so that they can get converted in diastereomers, right? So this was the resolution. This was the resolution of dextro and levo compound from the racemic mixture. Now the next definition that we need to understand is meso compound. Next definition that we need to finish is meso compound. For meso compound, what I'm saying, see, I have already explained that it is not necessary that if a compound is containing more than one chiral carbon, it is optically active. That may or may not be optically active, right? If a compound is containing more than one chiral carbon, but still it is optically inactive, and when it can be optically inactive, when it is having either plane of symmetry or center of symmetry, right? So the definition of meso compound is if a compound is containing more than one chiral carbon and compound is optically inactive because of presence of center of symmetry or plane of symmetry, then such type of compounds are known as meso compound. Let us write the definition. If a compound contain more than one chiral carbon, more than one chiral carbon, compound may not be optically active, right? It is optically inactive. It is optically inactive if it contain plane of symmetry or center of symmetry, right? Plane of symmetry or center of symmetry. Such type of compounds are known as meso compound, right? The definition, I think it is clear to you. There is one more statement about meso compound. You should know the statement also. The statement is the cancellation of or optically ऑप्टिकल इनएक्टिविटी इज बिकॉज ऑफ इंटरनल कंपेंसेशन ऑफ rotation of PPL. Likewise, we have discussed in racemic mixture that the racemic mixture is optically inactive because of cancellation of optical rotation, and that was known, that cancellation of optical rotation is known as external compensation. While in meso compound it is said that it is having internal compensation of optical rotation. How, why it is said that? Let's try to understand. First write the statement, then I am going to explain that. The statement is the cancellation of optical rotation In meso compound is known as internal compensation, right? Why it is said? Let us see an example. Let's say we have a compound 2,3-butanol, and the two OH group are on the same side in Fischer projection, right? If I have this type of compound, definitely we can say that it is going to have a plane of symmetry. This compound is going to have a plane of symmetry. So if it is having plane of symmetry, this compound is going to be optically inactive. And if you look carefully, this compound is having two chiral carbon, more than one chiral carbon, and having plane of symmetry, compound is optically inactive, and this type of compounds are known as meso compound, right? What it is said, why this statement is said, the cancellation of optical rotation in meso compound is known as internal compensation. It is because if you look carefully, the above half portion is exactly mirror image of lower half portion. Just hide the lower half portion and just assume that downside any a particular group G is attached, right? Hide the lower portion and let's say here group G is attached. So if you look at the above portion, it is having only one chiral carbon. If the compound is having only one chiral carbon, that is going to be optically active. So above half portion is optically active, and that is going to rotate the PPL. Let us say above half portion is rotating the PPL in clockwise direction. That is what I am saying, that is dextrorotatory. Let us say above half portion is rotating the PPL in clockwise direction by the angle theta. Now let us hide the above half portion and again attach the same group G. I'm drawing that situation. Let's draw that situation. That will be more clear to you. I'm attaching a group G, OH and H in above half portion. In lower half portion, repeat the same thing. Break the compound from middle and attach any a particular group G on both sides, right? So each part of this molecule is going to be optically active, and if you look carefully, these two are mirror images of each other. If above half part is dextrorotatory, lower half part is going to be levorotatory. If above is levo, then downside is going to be dextrorotatory, right? So what I am saying, just by seeing that, I can conclude, if the first chiral carbon is rotating the PPL in clockwise direction, the second chiral carbon rotating the PPL in anti-clockwise direction. So the cancellation of optical rotation is because of presence of chiral carbon in the same compound. We do not need the external compound to cancel out the optical rotation. That is why it is known as internal compensation. That should be clear to you. meso compound, in meso compound optical rotation is cancelled and that is known as internal compensation. One more statement, this statement is also important and will be used in problem solving. Racemic mixture and meso compound both are optically inactive. A racemic mixture is known as resolvable. That we have done earlier, we resolved the racemic mixture in dextro and levo, while this meso compound is non-resolvable, right? Meso compound is a single compound, you cannot resolve it, right? So this is about the meso compound. One thing is also very important for the problem solving. You should identify a particular compound, whether that given compound is meso or not. Sometimes it may happen that directly you are unable to find the plane of symmetry or center of symmetry. Let's take a situation and try to understand. There are some compound directly you cannot identify that particular compound is going to have plane of symmetry or not. Let's say I have OH and here it is CH3, and then OH and F. If it is asked whether this compound is going to contain plane of symmetry or not, or center of symmetry or not, just by seeing the structure it is difficult to find whether it is having plane of symmetry or center of symmetry, right? To do that, let me check once, then I'll tell you whether it is going to have the plane of symmetry or not. And to check plane of symmetry and center of symmetry, just find the configuration of the chiral carbon. Let us find the configuration of first chiral carbon. OH is of first priority and this downside group is going to have second priority for the first chiral carbon. CH3 will be of third priority, hydrogen will be of fourth priority. Start moving from first priority to second priority and then second priority to third priority. You are moving in clockwise direction and lowest priority is on horizontal line. So the configuration of first chiral carbon is S, right? For the second chiral carbon, again OH is of first priority and this larger group is of second priority, CH3 is third priority. It is in anti-clockwise direction, lowest priority is on horizontal line. It is going to be R, right? Yes, this compound is meso compound. This is going to have plane of symmetry. But just by looking the structure, we are unable to find whether it is containing or not. It is quite confusing, right? So, what I am telling you, I'll show you how it is having plane of symmetry. If you want to see whether this compound is having plane of symmetry or not, you just need to convert this Fischer projection in Sauhaus projection. And I have already explained the process how the Fischer projection can be represented in Sauhaus projection. Let us see this molecule from bottom side and hold this OH and CH3 group and hang at the ceiling. If you are going to do that, carbon number 2 and 3, let us say I am doing the numbering from bottom side, it is 1, 2, 3, so carbon number 2 and 3 covalent bond is this slant line. I am looking the molecule from the bottom side, so CH3 and OH are hanged to the ceiling. Now on carbon number 2, CH3 is on above side, hydrogen is on left side and OH is on right side. So just draw the structure that looks like, right? Hydrogen is on left side and OH is on right side. This is our carbon number 2 and this is carbon number 3. On carbon number 3, CH3 is on left side and hydrogen is on right side. I have repeated many times that if you are rotating a covalent bond, if you are rotating atoms around covalent bond, because of rotation around single covalent bond, the compound is not going to be changed, right? So just do one thing, just hold the carbon number 2, just hold the carbon number 2 and rotate the carbon number 3. It is the covalent bond, it is the single covalent bond between carbon number 2 and 3. Hold the carbon number 2 and start rotating this carbon number 3, right? And rotate the carbon number 3 by 120 degree. This angle between, bond angle between OH and H, H and CH3, CH3 and OH in the projection is 120. So if you are going to rotate the carbon number 3 by 120 degree, let me draw carbon number 2, keep the carbon number 2 same, hydrogen and OH. Now if you are rotating the carbon number 3 by 120 degree, this CH3 will move above side and this OH will be on right side and this hydrogen will be moving on left side. Now in this structure, in the last structure, if you observe, it is having a plane of symmetry. It is having a plane of symmetry. But the Fischer projection that was given originally, it is very difficult to identify whether it is having plane of symmetry or not. So I have a trick. I have a trick in Fischer projection also. Just by seeing the Fischer projection, we can decide whether it is going to have the plane of symmetry or not, right? But that trick is for compound containing 2 chiral carbon atom. And most of the time in JE mains exam, advanced exam or NEET examination, they are asking for the compound containing 2 chiral carbon only. So trick is going to work here. Let's try to understand. See, if you are saying, if you want to identify the meso compound, no? Meso compound having 2 chiral carbon, then definitely it is going to have the plane of symmetry. And if it is going to have plane of symmetry, one thing is very, very essential, that the groups or atom attached around the chiral carbon must be common. If the groups attached around this chiral carbon is not common, definitely compound is not going to have plane of symmetry, right? First thing you should keep in your mind, for meso compound containing 2 chiral carbon, meso compound containing 2 chiral carbon, groups attached to chiral carbon must be common, right? Now next, again, in definition we were discussing that if the upper part is dextrorotatory, lower part is going to be levorotatory, right? And both part are individually optically active. Both part are individually optically active. So what I am saying, if it is happening that both part are individually optically active, above part is dextrorotatory and lower part is levorotatory, then definitely the configuration of chiral carbon is going to be inverted. I was written the configuration of chiral carbon. You can find here also. OH is of first priority. This particular group is of second priority for the first chiral carbon atom. CH3 is of third priority. You are moving in clockwise direction. Lowest priority is on horizontal line. Configuration is S. I'm not going to find the configuration of second chiral carbon. Definitely it is going to be R. You can understand why. It is just because second part, lower part is mirror image of above part, right? So, second point that you should keep in mind to identify whether the compound is optical, whether the compound is meso or not. One chiral carbon, or we can write the configuration of both the chiral carbon must be different. If you are keeping these two points in your mind, you can identify whether the given compound is meso or not, right? First point is, all the atom or group of atom attached around chiral carbon must be common. And second point is, the configuration of both the chiral carbon must be different. If one is R, second must be S. If one is S, then second must be R, right? So these are the conditions to identify the meso compound. Meso compound, I hope the definition is clear, and you can find the meso compound directly in Fischer projection, right? Just look at the configuration. If the configuration are different, but remember the these conditions are for the compound containing two chiral carbon only. If the compound is containing more than two chiral carbon, these may not be working, right? So let's start next. Next is we have the last part of optical isomerism, very similar to that geometrical isomerism. In geometrical isomerism, in the last part, we were doing calculation of number of geometrical isomers. Similarly, here also, we are going to have calculation of number of optical isomers. Let's start. Calculation of number of optical isomers, right? Case one, if compound cannot be divided into equal part. If compound cannot be divided into equal part, let us say example of this. First write the formula. Number of optical isomers or number of optically active isomers, because in this case you are not going to get the meso compound. Isomers, it is 2^n, where n is number of chiral center or number of optical center, right? So just copy this formula and remember this one. This is going to be used. Let's take an example of this case. Compound cannot be divided into equal part. It is CH3CH CH3. It is CH2 bromine and chlorine. You cannot divide this molecule into equal part. this molecule cannot be divided in two equal part, but it is having two chiral carbon. It is having two chiral carbon, right? It is having two chiral centers. So in this molecule, if you want to calculate number of optical isomers, it is going to be 2 raised n, where n is number of chiral center. We are having two chiral center, which is 2 raised to 4, right? Total number of optical isomers will be 4. We can manually count them. How we can do that? Let's say at first chiral carbon the configuration is R, at the second carbon chiral carbon the configuration is also R. Now the next possibility is I can take at first chiral carbon configuration R, second chiral carbon the configuration is S, S, R and SS. These are the four possibilities, right? These are the four possibilities that we are getting from the formula. Number of optical isomers equal to 4. This formula can be used only when compound is not divided in two equal part, right? Now let us start the next case. If compound can be divided in two equal part, if compound can be divided in two equal part. If compound can be divided in two equal part, then in this case we are having two separate formulas. First one, number of optically active isomers. See, the statement is changing, right? In last case I was written number of optical isomers, now I am writing number of optically active isomers. Means this case is going to include some compound which is also optically inactive. For optically inactive I am going to write the separate formula. For optically active it is 2 raise n minus 1 and 2 raise n minus 1 minus 2 raise n minus 1 divided by 2. First formula, 2 raise n minus 1 will be used when n is even. Second formula, 2 raise n minus 1 whole minus 2 raise n minus 1 divided by 2. It will be used when n is odd, right? When n is odd. Now the next, number of optically inactive compound. Optically inactive compounds are what? Meso compound. Number of meso isomers is equal to, again we are having two different possibilities for even number of carbon atom and odd number of carbon atoms. It is 2 raise n by 2 minus 1 and 2 raise n minus 1 by 2. Second one, definitely it is for when it will be used when n is odd, and the first one for when n is even, right? Yes. So these are the formulas for the calculation of number of optical isomers. We are having optically active isomers, for that separate formula. Optically inactive compound, that is meso compound, for that we are having separate formula. Suppose in question it is asked, find the total number of optical isomers. Find the total number of optical isomers. And the compound is also can be divided in two equal parts, right? If it is said, find the total number of optical isomers, it includes optically active and optically inactive both, right? So if it is asked, find the total number of optical isomers. Number of optical isomers, then just add these two. Just add these two, optically active and optically inactive both. If you are adding even with even, you are going to get 2 raised n minus 1 plus 2 raised n by 2 minus 1, and this is for n is equal to even. And also add the second one, you are going to get 2 raised n minus 1, this is for n is odd, right? These are the formulas you should keep in your mind for the calculation of number of optical isomers. We are having very very good question on these formulas, or there are some situation where I am not preferring the formula, and there are some cases, but the question may be asked from this person. I'll give you the question based on these formula in assignment. I'm going to discuss one case which is important again, and that can be used for the calculation of number of optical isomers, right? Let's take the situation, last case, last part of optical isomers, rest problem based on these formula I'll give you in assignment, right? One more case I want to discuss. Suppose I have a compound which is containing even number of double bond. Let's say it is CH3CH double bond carbon, again double bond carbon. It is CH3NH again. Compound containing even number of double bond. I'm just giving you the statement. Compound containing even number of double bond on adjacent carbon atom can be optically active. Compound containing even number of double bond on adjacent carbon atom can be optically active. Remember, some of you may think that this compound can also show geometrical isomers, but remember the statement, compound containing even number of double bond on adjacent carbon atom cannot show geometrical isomerism. It can show optical isomerism. Let me write the statement, then I'll explain this statement by using this compound. Compound containing even number of double bond, even number of double bond on adjacent carbon atom, can show optical isomerism, but cannot show geometrical isomerism. Remember this statement. Reason, what is the reason behind that? Let's see the situation. First double bonded carbon, if you look at the hybridization of first double bonded carbon, it is sp2. The hybridization of second carbon is sp, and the hybridization of third carbon is going to be again sp2, right? Now the next is, if the hybridization of first double bonded carbon is sp2, then the shape around first double bonded carbon atom is going to be trigonal planar. The atom or group of atom attached around first chiral carbon atom should be in a single plane, that is trigonal planar plane. Now the hybridization of second carbon is sp. So around the second double bonded carbon, second carbon, the shape will be linear. That means first double bonded carbon and third double bonded carbon and second double bonded carbon must be in a single line. So it is represented in same way, that carbon first, second and third double bonded carbon atom are in single line, right? Now one more thing, if you look at the location of pi bond between first and second double bonded carbon atom, if you are taking this trigonal planar shape in the plane of board, then the pi bond between carbon number 1 and carbon number 2 will be perpendicular to the board. Remember this thing. I have already explained that if you are having a planar shape and the two atoms in planar shape are having pi bond, then definitely pi bond will be perpendicular to the plane. So the pi bond between 1 and 2 is going to be perpendicular to the plane of board. Now if pi bond between 1 and 2 is perpendicular to the plane of board, then definitely pi bond between 2 and 3 is not going to be perpendicular. Is not going to be perpendicular. Reason, if you look at the second carbon atom, second double bonded carbon atom, it is x axis, y axis, and perpendicular to the board is z axis, right? If you are saying the pi bond between first and second double bonded carbon atom is perpendicular to the board, that means pz orbital of first double bonded carbon atom and pz orbital of second double bonded carbon atom are overlapping to form the pi bond, right? And second double bonded carbon atom are going to have only one pz orbital. So pz is involved with the pi bond formation, in pi bond formation with the first double bonded carbon atom. So definitely the second pi bond formation between carbon number 2 and 3, in that pi bond definitely pz is not there. Pz is not there. Definitely again px will also not be used because px is involved in sigma bond formation. So the pi bond between carbon number 2 and 3 will be formed by the overlapping of py and py, right? What I am saying, conclusion is, the first pi bond, if the first pi bond is perpendicular to the board, second pi bond is in the plane of board. Now look at the third double bonded carbon atom. Again its hybridization is sp2, and if it is hybridization is sp2, again around third double bonded carbon atom the shape is going to be trigonal planar. Join this group around third double bonded carbon atom, it will be trigonal planar. But definitely keep in mind, if the pi bond between 2 and 3 is in the plane of board, then definitely this trigonal planar shape is going to be perpendicular. I have repeated many times that if you are having a planar shape and two atom in planar shape are having pi bond, then pi bond and planar plane are going to be perpendicular to each other. So the conclusion is this CS3 and H will be out of the plane. Let's say this CS3 is inside the plane and this hydrogen is above side the plane, right? It's a situation like CS3 and H is in the plane of board, and CS3 and H is outside the plane of board. Second CS3 is inside the plane and hydrogen is above side of the plane. Now in this situation, let me show you. Let's change here. Just wait. This is the situation. First CS3 and H in the plane of paper, and second CS3 and H are out of the plane of paper. So if you calculate, if you find the distance between these two CS3, let's say that distance is L1, and you are changing the position, how it we can change. Let's say we are changing the position in a space, right? And again calculate the distance between CS3 CS3. You are going to get the same, right? You are going to get the same. That means the relative position cannot be changed if even number of double bonds are present on adjacent carbon atom. That's why I have written, if even number of double bonds are present on adjacent carbon atom, it cannot show geometrical isomerism, but it can show geometrical isomerism. And especially in the case if this group G1, G2, G3, G4, G1 is not equal to G2 and G3 is not equal to G4, this compound is going to be optically active. This is a lean type compound we have already discussed, right? So next statement is if odd number of double bond are present on adjacent carbon atom, then such type of compound can show geometrical isomerism but can not show optical isomerism. Next statement that I am going to give you, a compound containing odd number of double bond on adjacent carbon atom cannot show optical isomerism but can show geometrical isomerism, right? Let's say we have 3 double bond on adjacent carbon atom, and again group G1, G2, G3, G4 are attached, right? G1 is not equal to G2, G3 is not equal to G4. The condition is still maintained. G1 is not equal to G2 and G3 is not equal to G4. In such type of compound, if you find this G1, G2, G3, G4 are in same plane. All the atom in this molecule are in single plane. And if all the atom of this molecule are in single plane, we can slice the molecule. Suppose this is the molecule, right? This is the molecule. We can slice it in between, right? Two part will be separated and both will be the mirror images of each other. So if you have doubt how we can see that all the atom in single plane, we can proceed in similar way that we were doing in last case. First carbon is sp2, second is sp, next carbon is again sp, and the fourth carbon is again sp2, right? Let us say if the first carbon is sp2 hybridized, the shape around this carbon is going to be trigonal planar. So I'm assuming that this first trigonal planar shape is in the plane of board. And if it is so, the pi bond between 1 and 2 will be perpendicular to the board. So the next pi bond will be in the plane of board. Next pi bond is again going to be perpendicular to the board. So the trigonal planar shape at the last carbon atom will be in the plane of board. All the atom are in the plane of board. We can slice the molecule. We can have the plane of symmetry. So such type of molecule cannot show optical isomerism, but it can show a geometrical isomerism if G1 is not equal to G2 and G3 is not equal to G4. So remember this statement. A statement is very, very important, right? This is the end of optical isomerism. From the next class, we are going to start conformational analysis. I'll start with the conformational analysis. And also I'll give you one assignment. Again, I'm reminding you, do solve the assignment. It is very, very important for you, right? Let's meet in next class. Bye bye.